Animal vision is a remarkable thing. Like, photons of light enter an eyeball and they somehow turn into electrical signals in the brain. That's amazing. It's something I've always wanted to understand. And thanks to my last video, I finally got the chance to sit down and work through it and figure it out. It all starts with one molecule called retinol, which I've built here. So retinol is an arrangement of a specific number of carbon atoms, hydrogen atoms, and one oxygen atom joined together in a specific sequence. But despite that specific sequence and number, there's a lot of variability in the form of the molecule. Like, look, I can twist it around, move this around over here, and change the shape of it. Except that in reality, a molecule like this tends to find an equilibrium for itself. Like, look, if you think about these two hydrogen atoms, for example, these hydrogen atoms are slightly positively charged, and so they repel each other. But then look, these two hydrogens are repelling each other as well, so it's gonna find some kind of equilibrium like this. And actually, you know, you need to worry about these ones. You need to worry about the arrangement of all of these different charges to figure out what the stable equilibrium of a molecule like this is gonna be. But anyway, it's something like this. Though, actually, a molecule like this is going to have more than one stable equilibrium arrangement. It's a bit like a switch in that way. Just to make the point clear, I got this thing 3D printed. I wanted to get it 3D printed anyway. This is a bistable switch. And look, it's in a stable equilibrium at the moment, because if I try and push it away from that equilibrium state, I can push it away, but when I remove that force, it relaxes back into the equilibrium position. But if I apply enough force, eventually it snaps into a different equilibrium configuration. And this is a stable equilibrium as well, because look, if I apply a force, I can deviate it from its equilibrium, but when I let go, it relaxes back into it. It's a bistable equilibrium. And a similar thing is true for this molecule. So if you give it enough energy, you can switch it from one stable equilibrium to another. And in this case, it switches from this arrangement, which is called 11 cis retinol, into this arrangement. So this swings up and it becomes all trans retinol. So how do you give a molecule like this energy to make it switch? Well, you do it with photons. So think of a photon as a packet of oscillating electric and magnetic fields. Let's ignore the magnetic field for now and just, so you imagine a photon's coming in and it's really an oscillating electric field, and charged particles feel a force in an electric field. So the particles are going to feel an oscillating force in the oscillating electric field of a photon. And so this, you know, it's going to be wiggling around, and because you've got all these charged particles in here feeling a force. And if the photon is energetic enough, you'll make it switch into this arrangement. In reality, it's not just about the photon having enough energy, it's also about the oscillations of the magnetic and electric field having the right frequency. And so what you have is an absorption spectrum. So this molecule is good at absorbing a range of frequencies. It'll peak at one particular frequency and die off either side. So that's step one. We've got loads of these molecules called retinol in the cells in the back of our eyes. They can absorb photons and it changes their shape. But how does that then eventually lead to electrical signals in the brain? And also, if there's only this one molecule, how can we perceive different colors of light when you've got this one absorption spectrum for this one particular molecule? Well, retinol is kind of useless on its own. In the cells in your eyes, retinol is found embedded in much larger molecules, in proteins. And here I'm representing the larger protein molecule with this white fabric. And the way to think of it is the bonds between the retinol molecule and the opsin molecule are pulling on the retinol and slightly changing its shape. And depending on the subtle way that you change the shape of retinol, it will affect the absorption spectrum. It will affect which photons of light it preferentially absorbs. So in the different cone cells in your eyes and in the rod cells in your eyes, you've got different proteins. They're called opsins. This is what the protein actually looks like, by the way, nothing like a white sheet. So the opsin that you've got in your rod cells is called rhodopsin. And then in the three cone cells in your eyes, you've got three different phototopsins that twist and slightly modify the shape of the retinal to make it absorb either light in the red end of the spectrum or light in the middle of the spectrum around sort of green or light in the blue end of the spectrum. So that's how a single molecule can be slightly modified by its host protein to absorb different parts of the spectrum, to be sensitive to different parts of the spectrum. So here's how it goes. Photons of light come into your eyes. They're absorbed by the retinal molecules. The retinal molecule changes shape. That pushes on the opsin protein that it's embedded within, and that changes the shape of the opsin protein. But here's the thing. This whole time, the opsin protein has been holding on to another molecule called transductin. And when you change the shape of the opsin protein in this way, it can't hold on to transductin anymore, and it's released into the cell. So you've got this transductin molecule flying around in the cell. That reacts with something that, and then that thing that reacts with something else. You've got this chain of reactions, but eventually the final thing, the most important thing, is this molecule called CGMP. And you can think of that as like a doorman. Okay, it's holding a door open in the membrane of the cell. So in the membrane of the cell, you've got loads of these things called sodium channels. And it's like a door that allows sodium ions into the cell. So this whole time, you've got sodium ions flooding into the cell. But when this CGMP is turned into GMP, it's almost like lopping the arm off of the doorman. It can't keep the door open anymore. The sodium channel closes, and then the concentration of sodium ions inside the cell starts to go down. And if you know about neurons and axons and cell-to-cell communication, you'll know how important that is. Like, if you've got a high concentration of sodium ions inside the cell, that's like an action potential, which is important for all that stuff. And actually, what's weird is when there's no light, the sodium channels open and you've got this action potential. In other words, the rods and cones are turned on, neurologically speaking, when there's no light. When the light shines in, they turn off, neurologically speaking. So, in fact, the next cell in the sequence, the next cell down the neurological chain from the rods and cones, is like a NOT gate. It's called a bipolar cell. So when the rod or cone cell is on, the bipolar cell is off. And when the rod or cone cell is off, the bipolar cell is on. That way, when light comes in, it corresponds to an on signal. A couple of interesting things to add. There's actually a fourth type of opsin protein that isn't in your rods or your cones. It's in a cell called an intrinsically photosensitive retinal ganglion cell. And this opsin is called melanopsin, and it makes the retinal molecule sensitive to the blue end of the spectrum. And if you follow the chain of neurons into the brain, it goes to a region of the brain called the suprachiasmatic nucleus, otherwise known as the body clock. So when the sun rises in the morning, it streams into your eyes, it gives you that blue light, a signal sent to your body clock saying, wake up. That's why people turn the blue down on their phones before going to bed. It's so that their blue light doesn't keep them awake. The final thing to do is add clarity to what I said in my last video, where I showed the sensitivity spectrum of your red, green, and blue cone cells, which you might now understand as the absorption spectrum of the retinal molecule as it's found embedded in the different opsin proteins in your red, green, and blue cones. Except that the graph that I showed you is kind of a lie, or as I called it then, an oversimplification. Because actually, if you look at the absorption spectrum of these different opsin complexes, then it looks like this. And look, the red opsin peaks at yellow. It's not in red at all. And look how much it overlaps with green. They're right next to each other. And the blue actually peaks at violet. So why do we call them red, green, and blue cone cells? When they should be called yellow, green, and violet cone cells. Well, actually, we don't call them that anymore. That's kind of historical. What we call them now is short, medium, and long, because of the different wavelengths that they absorb. A more probing question would be, why do we use red, green, and blue pixels on a display? Why don't we use yellow, green, and violet, given that those are the peaks of the absorption spectrum of the opsin complexes? And the answer is that our visual system does some post-processing on the signals that come from our cone cells to try and tease apart the information, especially between red and green, because they're so close together. So it's called the opponent process theory of color vision. If this wavelength of light is coming into your eyes, then it's stimulating your red cones and your green cones, but it's stimulating your red cones a lot more. So that gives you a sense of how the calculations work, if you can call them calculations. I'm still going to call them red, green, and blue cone cells, by the way, because I find that easier. But you can then ask, what is the equivalent sensitivity of those three cone cells after all that processing has happened? And it looks like this. If you want to figure it out, you can maybe try and examine what's happening with the neurons, or you can just do some experiments on some people to figure out, like, what is the optimum? Like, if I wanted to just use three distinct wavelengths in different amounts to recreate the experience of human color vision, what would I do? And you'd end up with the distribution that I showed you, except that I normalized the blue down. In other words, like, if I wanted you to see this wavelength, then I need to shine this much red light, this much green light, and this much blue light. So there you go. I'm always fascinated by how complicated biochemistry is. You know, it's never just like, there's this chemical reaction and then that does that. It's like, this chemical reaction causes this to happen to this molecule, and then that changes that and does that and does that, until, you know, 10 steps later, it's the thing that you want to happen. Like, the process for regenerating all trans retinal into 11 cis retinal, it's like a 7-step process to get it back to the way it was. It's recycled back into the opsin complex. If nature were able to overhaul these biochemical processes, then maybe we'd end up with simpler chemistry inside us. But nature doesn't work like that. Evolution can't overhaul. Evolution works by tiny baby steps. And so we have in us these complicated systems. This video is sponsored by NordVPN. VPN stands for Virtual Private Network. You know that, but what does it mean in reality? Well, you're basically creating a tunnel between your device and some endpoint, right? One of NordVPN's endpoints somewhere around the world. You can actually choose which one if you want. And so what that means is, like, all the traffic coming out of your device is encrypted first, and then it goes through the tunnel. That's why it's called a tunnel, because no one can get at it on the way. Like, if you're in a coffee shop on their Wi-Fi or hotel Wi-Fi or something like that, no one on that network can see what you're doing. It's all gibberish to them. Like, if you're filling in personal information on a website, for example, it also adds a layer of anonymity. So, like, the services that you're ultimately connecting to, they don't know where you are. They think you're at one of the NordVPN endpoints around the world. They can't geotag you for things like advertising and other nefarious things like that. Like, your data is valuable, is the point. So, you know, do what you can to hold on to it. You really need to think about VPNs. You really need to. By the way, one of the benefits of this kind of like lack of geotagging that you can do with a VPN is, if you're traveling and you want to use Netflix or iPlayer or something like that, and it's blocked because you're not in the right country, you can just virtually switch countries. You do it through the NordVPN interface. It's one of the things I really like. It's very simple to do. If you go to nordvpn.com/Steve, you'll get 70% off for 3 years and an additional 30 days absolutely free. So check it out today. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, don't forget to hit subscribe, and I'll see you next time.